from shore to shore.
Come to Jesus, I surrender.
Savior, I surrender all to Jesus. I surrender, make me Savior, holy thine. Let me feel the Holy Spirit, truly know that thou art mine. I surrender all.
We finished up Isaiah last week, and this week we actually got one verse in Jeremiah. So we're going to go back to Jeremiah, and we're going to start in Jeremiah 11. Now, in this chapter, Jeremiah is talking to the children of Israel, basically to Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and he's reminding them of the same thing, some of the same things that Isaiah, that we saw in the book of Isaiah. It's this discourse between God and his children, trying to encourage them to stay within the boundaries of their covenant, the same covenant that was passed down. So I'm going to start in the first verse of Jeremiah 11. I'm going to read you a little bit there, and then we'll stop and have some comments after I finish the first few verses. Jeremiah 11, verse 1. The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord, say, hear ye the words of this covenant, and speak unto the men of Judah and to the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and say unto them, thus saith the Lord God of Israel, cursed be the man that obeyeth not the words of this covenant, which I commanded your fathers in the day that I brought them forth out of the land of Egypt from the iron furnace, saying, obey my voice and do them according to all which I command you. So shall ye be my people, and I will be your God, that I may perform the oath which I have sworn unto your fathers, to give them a land flowing with milk and honey, as it is this day. Then answered I and said, so be it, O Lord. Now, Jeremiah, like all the prophets, was calling God's children basically to repent, turn back to the covenant, and not just claim the covenant, claim to be something, live what they believed. And believe in so great a manner that they actually live it. He told me, he said, you got to obey. You got to obey my voice, and you have to do this. So often, as we look at the children of Israel, we quite easily will say, well, they were just up and down, up and down, up and down, up and down, up and down. And true, they would serve God and then they would turn away. They'd serve God and turn away. They'd serve God and turn away. And it took them into terrible bondage over and over. And it caused many generational problems just to be passed on. But as we study these children and we look at them, and as we go a little farther in this chapter, you're going to see that they were not really too much different than people are today. We see a lot of Christians today that they'll serve God fervently for a little while, and then they'll think something will get their attention, something will get, or, and one of Satan's favorite tricks to do these days is to try and touch somebody when they're in a tragedy or when they're in a difficult position, and they'll just get a little cold. I think that one of the reasons that so many Christians are not attending church services anymore is because of how the devil maneuvered them through COVID. And yes, we had to be careful. And you know, we tried to do everything we could do and move every mountain we could move so that we could open the doors of this church as much as possible. We've invested in the best sanitizing equipment money can buy. And we have literally spent hundreds of dollars on disinfecting and things to keep this building, this facility, as germ-free as possible. But when Satan finds something that we're an area that we're weak in, he's going to do everything he can to exploit that weakness. And what were some of the base elements that the children of Israel, maybe some of the base attitudes or the base problem, at the very bottom of the barrel, why did the children of Israel keep, let's take for instance, why did the children of Israel ask to have a king like everybody else? What do you think were some of their motives or some of their reasoning or some of the problems that brought that about?
Do you blend in with everybody else?
Well, they wanted to blend in. That's very... very possible.
Envy, maybe?
Envy? I think envy, yes. How about jealousy? You know, sometimes we can look at somebody from a distance or look at a culture from a distance, and we think, oh, that's just so great, so great, so great, so great. I've heard lots and lots of people talking about how great it would be to live in this area or that area. And we kind of tease each other about it all the time, about how great it is to live in Texas. Now, of course, with us, it's just such a fact that Texas does have a lot of benefits that other places don't have. But we also have some problems, you know, these weather problems that have created all of these fire hazards and these tornadoes and these things that come against us. They're just... I heard three different people that were thanking the Lord for the rain that we got last night, and then I heard several more talking about the trees that were taken out of their place and knocked over. My brother Jerry even had a tree knocked over at his place in the storm last night, and it was just one of those things that you just wonder about, but it's a part of the Texas negatives, is to have this crazy weird weather. But when people are, many times when people are looking out at some place else or some other thing, they really make some decisions that I have seen to be through my life kind of questionable decisions. And I've known of several families that, you know, packed up lock, stock, and barrel and went somewhere else, and pretty soon here they were right back because they found out that beautiful picture that they thought was on the other side of the world or on the other side, well, it just didn't turn out to be what they thought it would be. I think the children of Israel were, at a very base level, they were envious and jealous of the idol-worshiping groups that were around them because of the ease of life. What is one of the factors, or what is one of the features about idol worship that make it so attractive to people? Really? Okay, now let's stop here for a little, because this is important. Most idol worship is based around things that cater to human flesh. That idol worship many times is the things that people find enjoyment in for a season. Even the Bible tells us there's pleasure in sin for a season, but idol worship feeds to the carnal. It zeroes in on the carnal. And most idol worship, there's no accountability. It's just turn loose and do all these things that your idol worship allows you to do, and you don't have to have a guilty conscience because there's no boundaries and there's no accountability.
I had another thought about them wanting a king besides that. I think sometimes it would just stay the Old Testament the way we have is they wanted someone to be responsible, someone to blame. They wanted a leader that they could blame, because they got out of this covenant, they didn't, and it goes back to that me stuff we're talking about. They wanted to do what they wanted to do, but they wanted somebody else to be held accountable for it. And I think somewhere, someone was thinking, well, if we get a king, then God will blame him, not me. There's no personal responsibility, and that goes back to idol worship too.
They could have also been afraid that other nations would overtake them.
Yes, and I think that was.
So fear could have played into it, fear for their own safety.
Well, kind of going along with that, the modern day version is, have you noticed how quickly most everybody wants to blame the politicians for all the problems we have?
And that's the reason we give all of our politicians all the authority that they've received, is because we don't want to be...
We're kind of like that same situation with the children of Israel.
We don't want it to be our fault.
And we don't... You know, I was complaining several months ago, quite verbally, about special lady that's in the House of Representatives. I won't speak her name, but I know you don't care, but we're online here, and I got to have some manners somewhere. I know y'all are used to me being blunt, but some of these people on the camp, they don't know me that well, and I have to show a little respect once in a while, because you know, once this stuff goes on Facebook Live, it's there forever,
and then so I take it off.
Well, until Nancy takes it down.
She'll let it down before it gets too hard.
Yeah. So I was complaining about this lady and her activities and, you know, this. But then I just stopped in my tracks and I said, wait a minute. She is not the only person to blame for this situation. Those people in her constituency that continuously put her in authority and keep reelecting her and keep her up, they're just as responsible for all the stuff that she's, and they're just as guilty in my book as she is.
You're right.
But then I thought, wow, that means I got to take a more active part in what I'm doing in my world. I can't just sit back and say, well, I voted for so-and-so and he's okay, but I need to participate. The last few times that I've tried to participate in politics, you know, I've written some very, very prayed over and very meaningful letters, and I tried to communicate with some of our elected officials, and so far I haven't got to an elected official. All the screening people have kind of pushed me aside. So I wanted to participate. I wanted to help. The children of Israel were, let's use it a good old Texas term, they were wishy-washy.
Amen. We're all the way back to the base of Mount Sinai when Moses came down with the law.
Right.
And they couldn't face it. And they'd already made an idol of what they'd been by themselves for
not a short period of time.
Just a really short period of time. That first time he went up the mountain, they just freaked out.
And this is what I'm using this term wishy-washy, because that's what, as a pastor, I see in a lot of Christians. They're wishy-washy. Hot and cold, hot and cold, hot and cold.
Well, that permanently described the nation of Israel then in the Old Testament, because they were.
They were. And I think that some of the symptoms that caused it for them back then are just as alive and well today as they are for us. And while we're talking about a covenant that was made with Israel and brought down through Abraham, this covenant was perfected in Jesus Christ and passed down to us in the New Testament. And And the details of the covenant are not 100% the same from old to new, but basically they're even the New Testament requirements of covenant are actually more, what word do I want to use? They're actually more rigid than the Old Testament.
And they're also more plainly written.
And they are plainly written, that's true. And our examples are quite contemporary. We can see all our examples. Okay, let's go on now to verse 6 of chapter 11. Then the Lord said unto me, talking to Jeremiah, proclaim all these words in the cities of Judah and in the streets of Jerusalem, saying, hear ye the words of this covenant and do them. Again, hear and do. For I earnestly protested unto your fathers in the day that I brought them up out of the land of Egypt, even unto this day, rising early and protesting, saying, obey my voice. Yet they obeyed not, nor inclined their ear, but walked every one in the imagination of their evil heart. I've had so many people say to me through the years in a situation, well, the Lord knows my heart.
Yes, he does.
And the idea that you can do evil things, say evil things, practice evil things, and not have an evil heart is just an out-and-out lie.
That's right.
You cannot have a pure heart, you cannot have a good heart when you are sinning. And when you are not only sinning, but aiding and abetting other people to sin. Have you ever wondered why God wants us to put him first? What happens when we don't put God first? As Christians, when we don't put God, what happens?
We get off track.
Nothing works out right.
Mainly, we are in a position where we can be deceived so easily. The children of Israel are a blueprint that we can look back on of how they walked and how they lived and how they worked. But God, through Jeremiah, didn't beat around the bush and say, well, it'll all work out in the long run.
God knows your heart.
He didn't say that. And, you know, I don't know who the comedian was, but a long time ago there was a comedian come on. He was using this term, bless your heart.
Oh, that was Dolly
Parton. Was it?
That was Dolly Parton.
Well, I heard it from a comedian, a Christian comedian. I never heard, because I never followed Dolly Parton for nothing.
Oh,
who was it?
Mark Lowry
was the one that I picked it up from.
Yeah.
And the whole premise behind it was very funny, and it was very entertaining. But at the same time, it showed and revealed how a lot of times we have this attitude towards somebody, or we have it, it's our attitude, and it leaks out so much that our friends and our family can, well, bless your heart, because your head's not right. Do you know it's impossible for your heart to be right and your head to be wrong? They have to both be right at the same time. And that's what covenant is all about. And that's why God woos us into a covenant relationship. He draws us into a covenant relationship. God doesn't expect us to just say, I believe, I confess, I repent, and then be perfect. He doesn't expect that. But what he does expect us to do is to let him be first in our life and let his ministry back to us show us the path of righteousness. Show us the areas in our life. Because we don't all need the same exact areas worked on all the time. Sometimes you've got a strong area in your life, and that doesn't need work because it's strong. But you have another weak area over here. And a lot of times we try to sweep our weaknesses under the rug. Or we try to find some coping mechanisms. What does it mean, really mean, to cope with something?
To live with it.
To cohabitate with it. I want to cohabitate with this. I don't want deliverance. I don't want freedom. I don't want it gone from my life. I just want to learn how to find this place where I can handle it, where I can deal with it.
Well, and I think because it's part of the deception, we think that we don't think that we can be delivered from it. We don't understand that there is always the opportunity to be delivered from it. You know, because with psychology and psychologists and the mental health, what do you call that? Just that segment of population, they are just teaching us coping. That's all they're teaching us, is coping and compartmentalizing and putting things away and just not letting go. They don't teach you just to give it to God and let go.
Well, they don't teach what they don't know. But what they do know, they teach very effectively. And we've seen generation after generation of people that use it and depend on it. And we've seen a lot of people helped tremendously from this segment of our society and from this approach. Now, I do not in any way criticize anymore. I used to criticize people who just looked at the psychological aspect of things and use the psychiatrist answer or the therapist answer. I'm not criticizing them at all. Please don't think that I am. Because I think that just like everything in your life, until you come to that place that you're ready to enter into the covenant place that God has for you, you might need a certain level. God's not going to expect you to be perfect overnight. I said that already. He's going to help you work through these. That's why he says work out your salvation. So God's going to deal with you where you are. He may use, and let me give you an example that'll help you understand. I was told that I had blockages in my heart. And so I went forward and I used medical science, and medical science treated my physical problem in my heart. And I relied on that skill that I believe God gave these doctors skill, and God has helped man learn how to be a blessing to man. But at no time during the process did I turn my life over to the doctors of the heart doctors, and I didn't turn my life over to them so that they could determine everything about my life. One of my doctors said, "You'll never sing again." He said, "You'll have to retire from the ministry. You won't be able to preach anymore. You won't be able to work anymore." And just, he had a whole litany of things he said I would not be able to do. Now, here's where we have to decide, are we going to learn the coping skills, which would say, stop, retire, stop singing, stop preaching, stop doing these things, and go to physical therapy and just, you know, slow your life down, get your rocking chair and your shawl, or are we going to say, this, my choice is not to live this way. The way I said it was, this is not how I'm going to die.
The negative thing about, and I've had some experience with this, teaching you these coping skills, is now we call everything a disease.
Yes.
And these coping skills, they encourage you to blame someone else. And in my experience, they've even caused people to believe something that wasn't even true. And so if you're a believer, yes. If you're you and you're a believer, yes. You knew that though you used the doctors, the medicine, That's one avenue of God bringing us, and I had to be almost convinced of that because I wanted to be completely faith that God was going to do it or nothing was going to happen. And I was finally convinced by another believer, yes, it's okay to go to the doctor. But because I've struggled with that, and I've admitted that in my Sunday school class. But I think for a Christian to be encouraged to use coping skills, we know who teaches us to deal with our problems, and that's God, and He teaches us to be delivered from them. But sometimes in this psychologist place, if you don't find a Christian person that is also a strong believer, you're going to be just like Sherry said, you're going to be encouraged to just, well, okay, it happened, just smile through it and take this.
And it takes your focus just completely off of God, and you, it's all inward. It's all what's going on inside you. And there is no answer inside you without God.
Right.
There just isn't any.
Those demigods, those false gods that the nation of Israel sought, they were drawing, those gods fed their flesh.
Yes.
But it didn't do anything for their spirit.
No.
Because it built a dividing wall between them and the God of the covenant.
And it was because they rejected the covenant in order to embrace this other stuff. See, God says this plan, it's either or. It's either me or the devil. There's no middle ground. There's no gray area. There's no half in, half out. It's me or the devil. One of the...
Part of the problem with the coping thing is if you're only coping with a situation, it could actually lead you into sin. Because if you're not dealing with the issue at hand and getting rid of the issue that caused you to go into sin in the first place, you're not going to get rid of the sin by coping with the problem. And you've got to get rid of the problem.
You're just being a good person, rolling it around.
Yeah, you're just acting.
Well, it worked.
Does it have to do, it's like when Moses came down from the mountain, and they couldn't look on his face because it was showing, because he was reflecting the glory of God, and he couldn't do that. So the veil came in, he veiled it. And it's like that veil stayed there for the Israelites. Like, they never were able to look wholly upon anything of God until the coming of Jesus Christ, until he died on the cross. And then it only was gone for those who believed on Jesus and believed that he rose again the third day. Is that an element, is what I'm saying? Did that veil that came into place at that moment part of what their journey is?
Here's the thing. God didn't tell Moses to put a veil on his face.
Okay.
This was a response to the people.
Okay.
He responded to the people.
Okay.
So the veil was just something that was mentioned there as a...
it was for their carnal comfort. It was for their comfort.
They didn't want to confront their problem. So the veil was nothing more than a coping mechanism.
Okay.
Nothing more. And No, there's nothing spiritually symbolic.
I thought they couldn't look upon Moses because of the glory of God that was on him. They would have died if they had.
Well, I don't know about that part. And the reason I don't know is I just haven't studied it that deeply yet. You may be right, but I haven't studied it that deeply. But as we look at these situations, it's hard for us in our society, in our culture, to even think on an either-or basis. Because we have had so many options available to us all our lives. All of our lives we've had multiple options available to us. We don't like this situation, we just change over and we go a different direction. And in our world, we've done so many things to conquer Mother Nature. Things like air conditioning, things like ice machines, things we do all these things. Even our automobiles. You realize how many different inventions came together so that you could have that and have this ease of transportation. And I believe that as we move closer and closer and closer to the actual return of Jesus, the rapture of the church and the return of Jesus, we're going to see that Satan is going to use one weapon more than any other weapon. And that weapon that Satan is going to use is affluence. He's going to use prosperity and abundance of money, abundance of things, abundance of needs. He's going to use that until it gets down. And then when it gets to that really, really, really bad spot, when he said, okay, now I'm going to take all this away from you. And if you don't take my mark, you can't have anything.
Oh, yeah.
And that's our ease of life today. And I know that all we hear about is the poor and all of that, but even the people coming across the border have iPhones.
I know.
Or Androids, or they all have phones. Mm-hmm. And so we all have some form of that ease of life that you're talking about. That fluids, that
and that prosperity is Satan's going to heap it, and then when he pulls it back, then say, well, everybody wants what they had, so they get that mark, so they can get back into commerce, and they can get back into activity.
I've always said this, that Satan doesn't have to get you to believe in him. He just has to get you distracted from believing in God.
And that distraction is such an easy thing. I had a conversation with an old friend I hadn't come across in a long time, and you know how when you see somebody and you haven't seen them for how you been, what you been up to, and back and forth, and this friend was, as a young man, was addicted to narcotics, illegal drugs, and then he got away from the drugs, and actually God helped him into a relationship with God, and he got off the drugs. And then through a course of a lot of problems, you know, over the years, he turned to alcohol. And the last time I was ever around him much, alcohol, he was just in terrible shape. And so he went through a program. I don't know exactly where he went through it, but the program is called Celebrate Recovery. And he went through that program. And so he was telling me how long he had been in the program and how things had turned around. And I was just thrilled to hear that, you know, he was in this brand new place. And then as we were going over some things, he was talking to me and talking about some of the things that Nancy and I had been through. And he said, well, you know how it is for us alcoholics. I said, what? What do you mean how it is for us alcoholics? Are you calling me an alcoholic? He said, no. He said, I'm just talking about me. He said, I'm an alcoholic. I said, you just told me.
Yes.
You just told me a few seconds ago that, he said, well, once you're an alcoholic, you're always an alcoholic. Mm-hmm. I said, did they teach you that in your recovery program? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they did. I said, yep. Well, I tell you what, they lied to you.
Yep.
Not about their rendition, not about their, but they believe it. What they lie to you about is who God is. Because my God is not a God that's going to leave the brand of sin on your life forever. My God's going to set you free. He's going to turn you loose. He's going to make you a new creature.
Yes.
Woo!
Yeah, that's right.
Lord, he's changed. And he says, go and sin no more.
Amen, amen, amen.
A new creature in Christ.
Amen.
And I understand the mentality that he was talking to me about. But I wanted him to understand how God looks at deliverance, how God looks at forgiving sin.
But that's a crutch.
It's a coping. A crutch is a coping tool. Mm-hmm. You're right.
Exactly. Crutch.
And there's times when we need a crutch. When your leg's broke and you've got a cast and you got a boot on, you need a crutch. No problem.
Yeah, but when that leg's healed, you need to get rid of that crutch.
There's
yeah.
a time when you have to lay down the walkers, where there, you have to lay down the canes, where you have to walk on your own.
Either that or you give into it and you're never, ever truly delivered.
And then you're in those chains. Who said that? Somebody said that a minute ago.
It chains. Came from over there somewhere. Well, I understand. I understand the aging process and how that there might even come a time in my life that me and my walker have to go everywhere together because I can't get from point A to point B without it. But I'm not talking so much about the crutches, the physical crutches, as I am the emotional and spiritual crutches.
Like Oreos.
This,
like what?
Like Oreos. Or like pecan pie and ice cream. Oh, I had a complete failure last Sunday. We were there at the restaurant, and I could smell that apple pie back there, and I got it with two scoops of ice cream. Because I wanted Sister Nancy to go. But I understand those things. And I'm not talking about how that we might have to use a walker or we might have to use a wheelchair because of our age or because of the infirmity. You know, sometimes your body is not going to repair itself. Mm-hmm. And sometimes God doesn't heal your body. Sometimes he doesn't. Ron Fisher can tell us a lot of things about how to live with appliances. Mm-hmm. If I outlive Ron Fisher and he leaves this world, I'm going to ask them to give me all that hardware and I'm going to open up my own Home Depot because he's got enough hardware in his back to start another Home Depot.
He does.
And we got to talking about all of this because we look at the children of Israel and how they vacillated back and forth, in and out, serve God, don't serve God, serve God, don't serve God. And, well, we got a crowd watching us tonight. Thank you, Jesus. This is great. And, yeah, I've already waved at 14 people. Praise the Lord. That is wonderful. That thrills me. I'll try not to be so preachy, but it just comes out. It just comes out.
Well, I think if people want to learn how to cope, they need to read Proverbs every day. So much in there.
There is. And while the physical body is something that sometimes we can't do anything about, one of the things the Lord told me, plain and simple, was the reason I was dealing with some of the things I'm dealing with is because of the law of sowing and reaping. This is what God told me, for me. I'm not saying this for you, this is for me. You can't mistreat your body. You can't eat the wrong things too long, too much, and expect there never being results from that in your life. It's going to happen. And so what we try to do is we try to turn our habits around. We try to go a better way and help the body as much as we can. But brother and sister, what I'm concerned about are these people that tell me and tell the world how much they love Jesus, but there's no fruit. There's no fruit whatsoever. We gotta have fruit somewhere.
It's because it's not Jesus that they love. It's the symbolism of Jesus that they love.
I think in many cases that's true. We have, in our culture, we have turned certain things into a staple. This is a part of our society. This is what defines us as Americans. This is what defines us as Texans. You know, I actually heard it said that, and I mean very, very clearly said that all Americans are Christians. Really? Okay. I'd like to believe that, but if all Americans are Christians, I think somebody needs to redefine what Christian is.
Yeah.
Of course, I've been trying to.
That is, we call America a Christian nation.
And we.
Everybody thinks, oh, went to America, could be a Christian.
Yeah, there is a large segment of our nation that calls America a Christian nation, but the truth is, America is not a Christian nation.
No, we've slipped from that.
We were never there. We were never a Christian nation.
That is true, but we are further away from it now than we ever have been before.
Our Constitution is built on some Christian values, but.
Values and principles are there in the Constitution, yes. And that's wonderful. Even it's there. It's obvious it's there. But when we, and I think one of the reasons America has been blessed as much as they have is because the element of America that is Christian has invested so much in the whole world that God has obligated himself. You know, he told Abraham, everybody blesses you, I'm going to bless them. And anybody curses you, I'm going to curse them. Well, when we're out there as Christians and we're blessing other people, not because we have to, but because we love God and we want them to love God and we want them to have their food and have their things.
And we have not turned our back on Israel as of yet.
That's right.
We've supported Israel. That's one reason God has blessed us.
Well, and we're in a very, very precarious position there.
Yep.
One of the things I'm putting this comparison here between the children of Israel and their vacillation and how people today vacillate. I believe that if we're going to ever have this last day revival that we all want to have and that we talk about having, somewhere along the line we're going to have to say, here is the light. On this side is sin, and on this side is righteousness, and we're not even going to get close to that line. We're going to stay as far away from sin as we can stay. And when we get to that point, then we're going to start seeing our faith multiplied, and then we're going to start seeing the fruit of that faith coming to us.
Don't you think that's the reason God put all of this in the Bible for us? It's a map. It's a roadmap for living. This is what you don't do if you want to be blessed, if you want to live blessed. You don't do what the nation of Israel did. And I've said it, you've heard me say it many times in our Sunday school class. We look at the nation of Israel and we go, those crazy people, why didn't they just enjoy the manna and not wine? What about us crazy people? Why don't we just enjoy the manna and not wine?
Amen. Yeah, I think the first third of my ministry, I was just a whiner. I didn't pray. I whined to God. I just, poor me. Lord, it's not fair. How come people like that preacher better than they like me? How come he gets to sing on television and I don't? Blah, 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 blah. You know, but you come to that point when you realize that all of that stuff is not really relevant to the call of God. That's why we were talking about in Sunday school on Sunday morning that our vision statement for Elm Grove is save souls. And we enhanced it on Sunday to save souls now. That's our whole vision statement for the church. When I know that that's not going to satisfy the generations that are coming into the church today, because they want all this stuff plotted out for them and laid out for them, and they want some kind of a roadmap to follow. Brother and sister, if I've learned anything, the farther you go down this road with God, the more you need to live by faith.
Yep. I'll agree with that.
And not by sight. Not go by what you feel or what you think or what people say. You got to live by faith and just put it all out there. Amen?
Amen.
Now let's go to a few more scriptures because we are fast running out of time here. I'm so sorry. I'm not sorry. It's been good. Let's just do 8. Yet they obeyed not, nor inclined their ear, but walked every one in the imagination of their evil heart. Therefore, I will bring upon them all the words of this covenant, which I commanded them to do. He said, I didn't recommend. He said, I commanded them to do. But they did them not. And the Lord said unto me, a conspiracy is found among the men of Judah and among the inhabitants of Jerusalem. They are turned back to the iniquities of their forefathers, which refused to hear my words, and they went after other gods to serve them. The house of Israel and the house of Judah have broken my covenant, which I made with their fathers. Therefore, thus saith the Lord, behold, I will bring evil upon them, which they shall not be able to escape, and though they shall cry unto me, I will not hearken unto them. Now, notice here that God is telling Jeremiah to say this to them. I will bring evil upon them. Now, how can you, based on current theology, explain that verse?
All God has to do is remove his blessing, and the evil will follow. Just like Toad, all he has to do is take that hedge away.
Satan couldn't get in as long as God had the hedge built. That's true with Job. But we find that even though there was a hedge built around Job all this time, there were still some things inside Job's heart and Job's mind that didn't quite float scripturally. Even Job had some wrong concepts about God, didn't he? Yeah. The evil that's in the world, and this is the controversy that is, of course, it comes up all the time. Where did evil come from?
From when they were kicked out of the garden, when they ate of that tree.
That's where sin originated.
Mm-hmm.
But
it's where, when they were kicked out of the garden, evil was roaming the earth.
Evil was roaming, but wasn't evil present in Lucifer before he, mm-hmm. before the serpent?
Self-pride, self-worth.
The evil started when Satan boasted of himself in heaven before God, and God had to kick him out.
So internally, in a created being, Lucifer,
with a free will,
who had a free will. Mm-hmm. I've had people say this all up. I've even had this discussion at seminary. If evil exists, then God created it, because God created everything. But the person that takes that stance doesn't understand what free will is. They have no concept of what free will is. And we know that the angels, created beings, had to have some level of free will. Because if they hadn't had some level of free will, Lucifer would have never indulged in his in his own thoughts, of his own mind.
Mm-hmm. Not just him. There was ones that fell with him.
Either he lured them to follow him, or they felt the same way he did. Mm-hmm. But they left with him. So where did evil originate?
From the sin of self. Pride
in heart.
In our carnal mind.
In our carnal mind. In our free will, knowing that I can have anything I want, anytime I want, and God will not stop me.
That's right.
But what happens to evil? What happens to evil when God says, "All right, son, go get your bride"? In eternity, what happens to evil? Only for a portion. Do you realize that one of the greatest torments of hell and eternity for the people that miss God, that turn away from God, that walk away from covenant, they're going to have to live with their own evil conscience, their own evil mind, their own evil forever, with no freedom and no release.
Separated from God.
No light will be present. No light will be present in him. You say, well, how can a merciful God put anybody in a place like that?
He does.
He does. Every person that spends eternity separated from God has rejected God and chose to be there.
Yeah. Just like the third of the angels that chose.
Oh, well, I left you in a deep, deep place to think. You've got something to really meditate on the rest of this week. And